the Japanese Ministry of Defense building in Ichigaya, Tokyo. Formerly used as the Imperial Army's Officer Training School, this is also where the Tokyo Tribunal was held in 1946 to try Japanese leaders accused of war crimes. The Tokyo Tribunal. While the tribunal was required to uncover the truth about the Pacific War, some believe the outcome was fixed from the start and called it victor's justice. All 25 defendants were found guilty, politicians and military alike. Seven were punished with death by hanging. The judges were appointed by the United Nations. But during 2.5 years prior to passing judgment, strong dissent and fierce maneuverings developed among the judges. This is the judge from India, Radhabinod Pal. He revolted against the court's intention to pass a unanimous guilty verdict. His viewpoints caused an uproar. What went on among the judges? We traveled to Europe, the United States, and Justice Pal's native country of India to research original documents in a number of archives. These primary sources revealed the fierce battles that Pal fought with his fellow judges.
The probability is that the trial would have collapsed on that single issue of was aggressive war an international crime.
初めから東京裁判の判決が決まっていたっていうのは俗論でありまして、この判事団の内部状況を見る限りは相当に動く可能性、流動性っていうものが存在したんだなっていうことが分かります。Even
audio tapes with the voices of some of the judges were found.
Well, and then came Paul, according to my memory, and said no, but I feel not bound by that decision, and I expect that I will have other opinions than you.
I never thought of favor or kindness. I wanted to do justice.
Why was Justice Pal pitted against some of his fellow judges? What was it that each of them tried to defend until the very end? The Tokyo Tribunal passed judgment on wartime Japan. To find answers, we looked for what went on behind the scenes. May 3rd, 1946. On this day, the International Military Tribunal for the Far East, commonly called the Tokyo Tribunal, commenced proceedings. The court's 11 judges were from the allied countries or their colonies, but the judges from India and the Philippines were chosen too late to attend the opening day. Sir William Webb of Australia acted as president of the court. Judges came from the United States and Canada, as well as the United Kingdom, the Netherlands, France, and the Soviet Union. Finally, there were judges from China and New Zealand. Prior to the opening session, they had come to the following secret agreement. Should an individual judge disagree with the final judgment, his opinion would not be made public until the end. This was a proposal by Professor Bert Rayling from the Netherlands. At 39 years old, he was the youngest among the judges. Conversations with Rayling were recorded on audio tape by a British historian.
It was on my proposal, because I am accustomed to my country that there is a secrecy of chambers and that there is only a majority opinion, and the judges understand the judgment as a majority opinion always, and of course minority doesn't play a role.
Two weeks after proceedings began, Justice Paul arrived from India. The first item that Paul contested was the tribunal's charter. This laid down the tribunal's rules and had been promulgated by Supreme Commander Douglas MacArthur 4 months before the court opened. The charter stipulated that the acts of planning and waging an aggressive war, or crimes against peace, and acts of aggression against civilians, or crimes against humanity, were now regarded as two new types of war crimes. The defense argued that criminal liability for accused acts that were not war crimes at the time was unjust. Presiding Justice Webb promptly dismissed the defense's motion. However, on July 5th, Paul sent a memo to all the judges. In the memo, he expressed his opinion that the accused could not be tried for newly defined war crimes. New laws cannot be enforced retroactively. To deem legal acts at that time as a crime post factum is unacceptable. Paul thus disagreed with a fundamental principle of the tribunal. The other judges were shocked. Paul's conduct was equally unexpected by the government of India. These are the National Archives of India in the capital of New Delhi. Available historical documents show that India did not originally intend to dispatch Justice Paul. India had fought Japan with the Allies as part of the British forces. Therefore, it claimed to qualify to nominate its own judge. India expected to become independent the following year. To dispatch an Indian judge was seen as a matter of international prestige. The British government supported India's claim. Great Britain expected this would dignify its own current suzerainty. However, although the right to nominate had been asserted, there was still no indication as to who would be dispatched. With only weeks away to the start of the tribunal, India was pressed to choose a nominee. Selecting a candidate proved to be a headache. We contacted Wadia, former Judge Bombay, but he has refused. Now we have approached Varma, former Judge Allahabad. MacArthur would like our decision by April 20th. Our fears that the tribunal could start without a judge from India. In that case, we would lose the right to dispatch an Indian judge. After a number of refusals, former judge of the Calcutta High Court, Radhabinod Paul, was finally nominated. This was only 6 days before the tribunal was scheduled to open. By October 1946, the prosecution had begun to present evidence. Starting with the Nanking Massacre, many facts about Japan's wartime conduct hitherto unknown to the general populace were presented to the court. Behind the scenes, disagreement among the judges about the charter grew more intense. On one side stood Justice Paul, who had publicly denounced the charter. The British judge, the Honorable Lord Patrick, opposed him. Patrick argued that the judges must loyally abide by the rules of the tribunal's charter. He circulated a 4-page memo to all the judges, urging those who objected to the charter to leave Tokyo. The authority of the judges in this tribunal is based solely upon its charter. All judges must abide by the charter. Whoever cannot abide by the charter should tender his resignation. To stay on as judge while questioning the charter's power and aims is an act of fraud against the Allies. Justice Paul did not stay silent. 6 days later, he sent a new memo to all the judges. This was a memo that explicitly criticized Lord Patrick. Concerning the memo of my esteemed colleague, Justice Patrick, I must confess I do not agree with him in any of his views. Justice Patrick's opinion, urging a fellow judge to resign, certainly appears somewhat misplaced in a note for the tribunal. Patrick kept in close contact with the government of his native Great Britain. The government wished for the Tokyo Tribunal to progress smoothly in keeping with the charter. In Europe, Great Britain fought fierce battles with the Nazis. To punish the Nazi leaders responsible for aggressive war and the Holocaust, the Nuremberg Tribunal had adopted two new legal notions, designating crimes against peace and crimes against humanity as war crimes. The British had dispatched Patrick to Tokyo to convict Nazi Germany's ally Japan of the same war crimes. Lord Patrick was an authority in the British legal community. At the young age of 48, he was chosen president of the Scottish Bar Association. Two years later, he rose to the position of judge on the Supreme Courts of Scotland. Former Judge Donald Ross was Patrick's junior colleague in the Supreme Courts. He asserts that Patrick's views faithfully reflected judicial opinion.
The principles that he laid down would still apply today, and I'm quite sure that cases that he has delivered opinions in must still be being referred to in the courts and giving guidance to present-day courts.
Justice Patrick asserted that to loyally abide by the tribunal's charter was the obligation of every judge on that bench.
The judges don't make the law. Parliament makes the law. The politicians, the legislature, make the law. and it's up to the judges to apply the law and to see that it is maintained. And we know the setting up of the charter and so on, which gave rise to the setting up of these tribunals. And whether you like it or not, that's the basis upon which these tribunals were set up. And from the point of view of a judge who's been appointed to that tribunal, his job is straightforward. He applies that law.
January 1947. More than 6 months into the trial, the prosecution was still presenting its case. The defendants were accused of the following: waging war in Manchuria and throughout China, waging war on the United States in the Pacific, and waging war on British, Dutch, and other colonies. The prosecution argued that Japan's leaders had centrally planned and premeditated these wars. The accusation was that of a conspiracy. Conspiracy, as used here, was an Anglo-American legal concept. Merely participating in the planning of a crime made one guilty of that crime. Meanwhile, Justice Paul had confined himself to his room at the Imperial Hotel in Tokyo. He was studying the tribunal's proceedings and various collected writings on international law. He wrote down his own views in a dissenting opinion that ran to 257 pages. Paul argued that the foreign policy of no country whatsoever could legally be judged a conspiracy. Conspiracy is not yet a crime in international law. As a result, I would dismiss all the counts based on this accusation. Once again, trouble stirred among the judges on the bench. Justice Patrick reported to the British government in January 1947. The Indian judge circulated a memo of 260 pages. Why ever did the government of India appoint this man? And why did our government support this? I fail to understand why. By what school of thought was Justice Paul formed? This is Kolkata in eastern India, where Paul lived for about 50 years, both before and after the Tokyo Tribunal. In the over 200 years that India was ruled as a colony by the British, this city was the center of a fierce struggle for independence. In the center of the city stands Federation Hall. This institute used to house the independence movement. The library holds the dissenting opinion written by Justice Paul at the Tokyo Tribunal 60 years ago. It is the original that he carried home after the tribunal. It contains over 1,200 pages, typewritten by Justice Paul himself and bearing his handwritten corrections. Arguments deriving from Paul's philosophy are present on each page. His strong condemnation of the colonialism of Western powers is part of this. Western countries command territories in the Eastern Hemisphere solely because they have secured the lands through armed violence. If properly scrutinized, none of these colonial wars would stand the test of being just war. Paul also directed similar criticism at Japan. He condemned Japan's imperialist rule over Manchuria as following the bad example of Western colonialism. That Manchuria fell into Japanese hands, creating the farce of Manchukuo, could only have come about through the wielding of Japanese military force. The origin of this policy can partly be explained by a desire to follow the example of the Western powers. That desire has been an ide fixe in Japanese minds since early Meiji times. What were the roots of Justice Paul's philosophy? We asked his son, Proshan Paul, himself an attorney.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for letting us. Yes.
He claims that his father's calm appearance concealed surprisingly strong convictions.
Actually, why my father? Every Indian regard Mahatma Gandhi. He is the father of our nation. So I think my father should not be an exception to that.
Mahatma Gandhi, the father of Indian independence. Although he was frequently persecuted while leading the insurgents against the British, Gandhi adhered to the doctrine of nonviolent resistance based on his pacifist beliefs.
Paul not only came from a disadvantaged, poor, low caste family, but he also came from a Hindu sect which was devoutly pacifist. He was a Vaishnava, like Gandhi. He came from a pacifist sect. And violence of the kind the two world wars had displayed must have been very painful experience for him.
Paul's abhorrence of violence is present on many pages of his dissenting opinion. He also shows his disgust at the atrocities of the Japanese army. He writes of the abuse of prisoners during the Bataan Death March in the Philippines. The Bataan Death March is really an atrocious brutality. Prisoners had to march 120 kilometers in 9 days under a scorching sun. About 65,000 American and Philippine prisoners were beaten and kicked by their guards. Those that fell out of the march, either too ill or too weak, were shot to death or bayoneted. These are Paul's comments on the Nanking Massacre. Even making every possible allowance for propaganda and exaggeration, the evidence is still overwhelming that the conduct of the Japanese armed force at Nanking was atrocious against civilians and prisoners. Paul also comments on the Japanese Army's conduct throughout the Pacific Theater. These are the instances of atrocities perpetrated against civilians at different theaters during the entire war. The devilish and fiendish character of the atrocities cannot be denied. Moreover, Paul castigates the use of the atomic bomb, comparing it to the atrocities committed by the Nazis. If the indiscriminate destruction of lives and property is still illegitimate in warfare, then in the Pacific War, the decision to use the atomic bomb is the only near approach to the directives by the German Emperor during the First World War and of the Nazi leaders. Paul thoroughly abhorred both the Japanese and the American atrocities, a consequence of his adhering strictly to the principles of absolute pacifism. April 1947. The defense had begun to present its arguments. Almost 1 year after the tribunal opened, it now looked to become a long affair. Two other judges from British Commonwealth countries, Canada and New Zealand, were the only ones to have aligned with Lord Patrick. Paul seemed to have no intention of compromising. Presiding Judge Webb failed to unify the bench and began to feel antagonistic towards Patrick and his group. The minority group of three felt themselves in a weak position. The result of this trial might undo all the good done at Nuremberg. If it were possible without loss of face, we had better cancel it altogether. Patrick proposed to his government to withdraw his group of three Commonwealth judges. This meant a possible collapse of the Tokyo Tribunal. A British diplomat called on Supreme Commander MacArthur to inform him of the crisis on the bench. The tribunal had been set up by order of General MacArthur. The British reasoned that MacArthur would not tolerate a judge that did not abide by the charter. But the British hopes were dashed. This is how the diplomatic mission reported to the British government. MacArthur did not take such a dramatic view of the situation as Lord Patrick. Justice Railing from the Netherlands heard MacArthur's opinion of the tribunal in person.
Then he expressed to me very clearly, I have been opposing this tribunal. I wanted to have a short court-martial concerning Pearl and nothing else.
Yoshinobu Higurashi, professor of international relations at Kagoshima University. Based on original documents collected from around the world, he aims to analyze the Tokyo Tribunal in light of the international situation at the time. Furthermore, to the British government, the Tokyo Tribunal was extremely important. Foreign Secretary Ernest Bevin could not agree with Patrick's proposed withdrawal. To abandon the Tokyo Tribunal would have a devastating impact. It would deal a shattering blow to European prestige. This is John Pritchard, Great Britain's foremost researcher of the Tokyo Tribunal. He argues that it was Great Britain's historic mission to assure that the verdict at Nuremberg was followed by a successful trial in Tokyo.
If this conception was to break down and a judgment were to be produced at Tokyo that said that aggression was not a crime that was known in international law and had no basis in international law, that it was a purely political act, then consider the damage that this would do. It would unravel the whole of the Nuremberg experience. This at a time where denazification was still a great agenda, still a great project in which all countries that were engaged in European peace and security had to take a common part.
Lord Patrick stayed on in Tokyo, deciding that the judges had to be aligned with him by his own doing. Meanwhile, Justice Paul had managed to find a sympathizer for his views. Professor Rayling of the Netherlands, the same judge who had proposed at the opening not to disclose any minority dissenting opinions. On the bench, Rayling and Paul always sat next to each other. The Dutch National Archives in The Hague hold documents that show how Paul tried to convince Rayling. This is the judicial diary that Rayling kept throughout the duration of the trial. It contains a note in a different handwriting. The signature is that of Radhabinod Paul. He wrote, "Judges from the victors' countries are seized by feelings of hate and revenge, so they are soon prepared to accept aggressive war as a crime after the fact." Rayling's native country, the Netherlands. A year after the outbreak of World War II, the entire nation was occupied by Nazi Germany. As a judge, Rayling showed signs of resistance to the Nazis. He was later relegated to a small countryside court near the Belgian border. After the war, the Netherlands was invited to delegate a judge to the Tokyo Tribunal to be chosen from among capable judges who had not collaborated with the Nazis. As a result, Rayling was selected to go to Tokyo at the young age of 39. Rayling's third son, Hugo, taught history at the University of Amsterdam. He came to know about Justice Paul and the Tokyo Tribunal from his father.
It was an adventure to him. And this adventure got the better of him, I would say. He went there, going to have a great time and teach those Japanese a lesson. This arrogant attitude was, I think, his. But he came back really a changed man.
To gain an understanding of Japan, Rayling traveled all over the country. This is how he commented on his experience of flying over Hiroshima.
We daarheen gevlogen zijn en lang gecirkeld hebben over Hiroshima. Plotseling zei iemand, daar was Hiroshima. En dan zie je een dal, niets, weg, de stad weg. Een gebouwtje erin dat toevallig is blijven staan. Je ziet de dingen dan en ik heb zo'n gevoel dat wanneer je de dingen ziet, dat die op je gaan werken.
This is a note that Railing wrote during the tribunal. It's an itemized summary of Justice Paul's arguments. Railing grasped its reasoning. Gradually, he came to take a sympathetic view of Paul's position. That Railing's arguments closely echoed those of Paul had transpired to the other judges. Lord Patrick planned to align the remaining judges into a majority group. Since Patrick was not the sociable type, this proved to be a daunting task. Moreover, he was suffering from tuberculosis and heart disease.
So Patrick thought that he should launch a sort of campaign, the most important campaign of his life, the most important campaign that any British representative in an international tribunal has ever waged. He did it at great risk to his health. It nearly killed him.
最悪の事態をパトリックはもしかしたら見ていたのかもしれません。まあ、7人、8人みんな小水拳出すとか、あるいは11人全員が小水拳出すとか。まあ、つまりは統一判決が出ない。これはもう裁判の手を出さなくなりますから。まあ、ですからまあ初めから東京裁判の判決が決まっていたっていうのは続論でありまして、この判事団のまあ内部状況を見る限りは相当にまあ動く可能性、流動性っていうものがまあ存在したんだなっていうことがわかります。
Railing's position had shifted away from Patrick's group. In July 1948, Railing wrote this letter to a diplomat friend. In it, Railing resists a majority verdict that simply replicates the final verdict at Nuremberg. The more I see of the draft verdict, the more I loathe the idea of putting my name to it. This is strictly confidential, but the draft is worse than anyone could have imagined. The draft simply begs to be discussed much more carefully. The Dutch government was aware of Railing's change of heart. The Foreign Office sent him the opinion of a legal scholar who repeatedly argued that Railing must join the majority in keeping with the Nuremberg trial. We strongly demand that you fulfill your duty as judge and request you accordingly to sign the majority verdict without reserve. The Dutch government maintains her opinion that it is highly undesirable to publish a dissenting opinion. Railing's resolve to resist this strong intervention by the Dutch government was backed by the words he received from Justice Paul.
Well, and then came Paul, according to my memory, and said, no, but I feel not bound by that decision, and I expect that I will have other opinions than you, and I will express that opinion. I feel entitled to it, it's the custom of my country, and I stick to it. And then I decided also to give a separate opinion.
Paul wrote this letter in October 1948 after he had learned of Rayling's decision. I am sincerely glad to hear that you have made up your mind to give a short dissenting opinion. We are not here to minister to the worst prejudices of the world's public opinions and mustn't sacrifice our own convictions. Justice demands this. Summer, 1948. The court adjourned after the greater part of the trial had been concluded. Justice Paul continued to write his opinion, secluded in his hotel room. Paul commented on that period during a visit by a Japanese scholar of international law after the trial.
I didn't spend a single moment in any other thing. I didn't see anything of Japan during the trial period. Well, the whole time was devoted to the preparation of this judgment.
Paul's labors resulted in a 1,235-page-long dissenting opinion. Paul pointed out the errors of Japan's wartime leaders. The statesmen, diplomats, and politicians of Japan were perhaps wrong, and perhaps they misled themselves in that they were not conspirators. They did not conspire. However, he concluded that all the accused were not guilty. To deem legal acts at that time as a crime post factum is unacceptable. His opinion remained unchanged until the end. Prior to the outbreak of World War II, international law had not yet developed as far as designating this conduct as a crime or as illegal. Judge N.N. Bhattacharjee, former president of Calcutta High Court, was once a junior colleague of Powell's. He says he discussed the Tokyo Tribunal with him.
All that he said, that one should not, from my judgment, come to the conclusion that I've supported the Japanese overall aggression also. He said aggression, though allowed under international law, is equally bad with that done by the Britishers or the Americans or the Japanese. That much is it.
Rayling sympathized with Paul. Breaking his vow to join the majority, he wrote his own dissenting opinion. He carefully considered the responsibility of each defendant. His verdict deviated from the majority by acquitting five politicians and diplomats, including former Prime Minister Kouki Hirota. According to Rayling, they had been against the war. Rayling also deviated from Paul's verdict. Out of the 25 accused, he found 20 guilty of crimes against peace. Also, strongly condemning atrocious conduct, he assigned blame to those who had failed to avoid war crimes in the field. Rayling meted out the death penalty to 9 military leaders, including 3 on whom the majority had passed only life sentences. Although strongly influenced by Paul's philosophy, Rayling discovered his own direction for applying international law to wars. His purpose was to prevent war from ever happening again.
We were in a kind of development against, in the direction of prohibition of war. and development that should be strengthened because the world needed it, by judging the vanquished is the only means that's open for international law to maintain the law after a war.
The attempt by Lord Patrick's group of three to create a majority bore fruit. Although their differences with presiding Justice Webb remained unresolved, they formed a majority together with the U.S., Soviet, China, and Philippines judges. Their group of seven counted more than half the bench. For his part, Justice Paul wrote a letter addressed to presiding Judge Webb. You must have noticed the extent of my dissent in matters both of law and of fact in the case. I earnestly desire you to read out my judgment in open court. November 12, 1948.
The International Military Tribunal for the Far East is now resumed.
Accused Hirota Koki sentences you to death by hanging. Accused Tojo Hideki sentences you to death by hanging.
The majority judgment found all 25 accused guilty, passing the death penalty on seven of them. Besides ordinary war crimes, the Tokyo Tribunal also recognized the two special crimes provided for in its charter, crimes against peace and crimes against humanity. Presiding Judge Webb reported dissenting opinions from five judges, including his own. Foremost was that of Justice Radhabinod Paul. However, Webb declined to read out the opinions in open court. This is how the Tokyo Tribunal came to a close after 2.5 years. 3 years later, Japan signed the San Francisco Peace Treaty. Following the Tokyo Tribunal, this signaled Japan's return to the international community. Paul returned to Japan three times, giving lectures around the country. Published as A Proclamation of Peace, this book contains his thoughts about the abomination of war. After traveling around Japan for a month, I have come to meet many Japanese. If I had to use just one sentence, I would say no more than Japan is a beautiful country. I am forced to question why this people, born and raised amid such lovely nature, should ever consider waging war. I don't stop repeating the following. To think that war is a way to achieve peace is a grave error. We should never repeat this error again. October 1966. This is from a taped record of Paul's final visit to Japan. Talking to a scholar of international law, Paul argues that the spirit of Japan's post-war peace constitution could provide inspiration to the world.
Japanese people should have another judgment. By our own judgment, we should reflect ourselves and we should pledge not to repeat these follies again, I think.
Well, that again is a question entirely lying with Japan.
Yes.
But I think why Japan alone, every country ought to think that it is high time that they dissociate politics with from force. Because force now has no utility whatsoever, if I can say so without exaggeration. Force has become absolutely useless.
3 months after this interview, Paul passed away at the age of 81. Rehling was appointed professor at Groningen University after returning home, and soon became the foremost Dutch scholar of international public law. His contacts with Paul continued for many years after the war. At the university, he set up the Institute for Peace Research, lobbying until the end of his life for the abolition of nuclear weapons. Lord Patrick, who instigated the majority verdict, returned to the post of judge on the Supreme Courts of Scotland. He failed to recover from the ailments that became aggravated in Tokyo and soon passed away. The verdict at the Tokyo Tribunal had recognized two new concepts of war crimes. Crimes against humanity was accepted by post-war international law and was incorporated in 2003 in the Charter of the International Criminal Court. However, crimes against peace is still contentious due to differing opinions about what constitutes an aggressive war. During the 2.5 years of the Tokyo Tribunal, strong dissent developed among the judges. The principal questions were how to pass judgment on war and how to secure lasting peace. These questions, which Justice Radhabinod Paul insisted upon considering, still confront the world today. Thank you.